All right, so basically, I'll start with like getting the frustrated part of my architect and out of me, and explain the Disney comment. Like basically, you know, pre-1950s Santa Barbara architecture is rooted in a lot of good architectural character, mostly imported from elsewhere by its colonizers, the Spanish. Most of Santa Barbara doesn't have this type of character that's worth keeping. Basically, if you go to Andalusia, the southern part of Spain, has a very similar latitude and the weather and geography to Santa Barbara. And it's a really amazing place to go visit because it has a real authenticity to it. Basically, I think what most people don't realize is that like the walls are thick in our architecture because they're made out of stone. And they're white because they're sealed with lime. And the tiles on our roofs are red because that's the soil color in that region. And here, it's just all wood frame construction and arbitrary paint choices, and it's just kind of like Disneyland. So, you know, here we have basically the four parts of the process. We have architects, neighbors, the boards, and the city council working around the design guidelines. And I'll talk about the top half of the diagram first. Basically, the design guidelines are meant to achieve an appropriate scale for the context, you know, have a size that's like not significantly larger than the neighborhood. You know, a bunch of really good things, minimize privacy impacts, protect our public space. They actually work really well, but very few people trust or understand these things. Going through the kind of the most important aspects, like on the top left there, properties over time used to be big with, you know, whatever size house, and have gotten smaller and smaller over time. And so you've had mansions always on bigger properties, and everyone's afraid of the McMansion in smaller things, but overall, all of our houses are really big compared to like the way most people live. So one of the biggest things on the guidelines is the floor area ratio. At the bottom you have the lot size, and on the left you have the house size. And basically on the left of the red line there, you have 85% of Santa Barbara properties, and that's where guidelines become regulations. So basically, on the left here, you have you know, flat lot conditions and hillside conditions. On the upper portions, you have what's typical, which is basically flat lots on the grade. And what the guidelines really ask for is that you dig in, and what it causes is a lot of dirt, which means a lot of export. So I had this client that basically wanted a house that like was inspired by nature. And so we created this thing that was radial as opposed to rectangular. You wanted green roofs, you wanted like, you know, a full solar and off the grid, you wanted like green materials, balanced cut and fill on site, minimizing impact in the neighborhood, and we had nothing but problems, right? We created this house that like, you know, basically you woke up with the sun on the east, you lived in the kitchen dining on the south, you had your afternoon entertainment on the west. And the neighborhood basically saw it as a spaceship and fought it, like, you know, just vehemently, because like they fly around in helicopters instead of in cars. So even though we could prove, like through the design process, that the existing house, which was like one third the size of what we were doing, appeared larger, and even though we were doing like, you know, everything that the guidelines wanted you to do, way under the height limits, natural materials, natural things, nobody bought into it. And part of the issue is that you're required to go through the process and submit plans and sections and elevations, which most people have no idea what they represent. And really, we see things in perspective, and the way that they actually are in perspective is much more diminished than what plans and elevations look like. So on the other side of things, you have like neighbors and suburban mentality and homeowners and associations that are always like rallying against kind of like this out of the box thinking of like site-specific architecture. And you have the boards and the city council that's there to kind of like, you know, referee the whole situation. So, you know, talking about like, you know, homes, basically 1950, when suburbia started, you had small homes on fairly large lots, and over time, like the houses have gone bigger and bigger, with the same correlation of TV watching increasing over and over and over, right? Like we end up with larger and larger houses because everyone's glued to the TV. And you have a dominant paradigm of people living in cubicles, taking their car to cubicles at work, being a cog in the machine, being connected to each other through, you know, technology, all, you know, running after money, which doesn't necessarily lead to happiness. And so what you end up with is the situation is instead of having like, you know, block parties and like meeting your neighbor on the street and like, you know, having conversations on the front porch, neighbors meet each other in these boardrooms. But they're not actually meeting each other, they're just fighting against somebody doing something that like is infringing in some manner on their privacy. And this kind of tendency keeps growing. Like, you know, the new age kids are instead of like playing ball on the street together and like having a clubhouse in the local treehouse, they're just isolated more and more and more. And this is the way that like our society is kind of been running along. It's not a community-oriented thing. So when you go through this process, like this was my process. Like basically for 2 years I was working on, you know, a project, meeting all of the rules, meeting all of the things. I was being told by the city that like you'd get expedited processing for innovative green projects, and at no port along the way does it actually come true. It's just like a war of attrition. And the worst part about it is that basically if a decision occurs where the neighborhood groups don't agree with things, they have a back door. For a mere $500, they can appeal the thing to the city council. They can have meetings with the city council before like a public meeting even occurs and basically sway the city council to rule for the majority of the public. And for me, it was like a slap in the face. We did everything the rules showed, and it ended up being kind of you know, just politics, just small town politics. And it was really like, it was disheartening. In the overall, like, you know, yes, I've got a lot of angst, but I've had a great time in the time in between. I've come back to town. It's a great place to be. There's good things here. I'm not sure I really ever want to go through the design process here again. Most of my projects are outside of town, which is great. You know, I think we just need to be all kind of a little more community-centered as opposed to the way that kind of we're running these things. Thanks.